to be here. First of all, thank you all so much for what you do. I mean, you really do help the museum serve our mission. And I mean, the tour numbers, just across the board, not just for Terracotta Warriors, but just from what I've heard, it's just amazing how many people you all reach. So thank you, thank you. And I look forward to getting to meet each one of you personally. I'm from Memphis, Tennessee. I worked with Kaywin. She hired me 11 and a half years ago. And I worked at the Brooks Museum for 11 years. I worked with docents, I did family programs, school programs, adult programs. When I was there, I developed our Alzheimer's tour program. I also developed an art therapy program that worked with veterans and at-risk teens and children. I led an interpretive planning project that covered the whole institution, but it was really thinking about the museum from the visitor's point of view. I mean, we even so much as went to the parking lot and walked in as visitors and really tried to look at the museum through visitors' eyes and make everything at the museum more accessible. And I'm hoping that work is still continuing there, even after I've left. Education-wise, I'm a lifelong learner. I have a degree, a BA in English, BA in art history, my master's in art history, and most recently, I was fortunate enough to be offered a CRESS fellowship to go to Bank Street College of Education in New York. So for 2 years, once a month, I got to go to New York and convene with colleagues who worked in museums from all across the country and really look at museum education as well as leadership in museums. So it was an amazing experience for me, and I finished that about a year and a half ago. And it's really impacted my work, and I've really developed a great group of colleagues across the country that are wonderful resources. So I have two daughters who are 6 and 8 who go to Lake Harriet Community School. We're leasing a house right now in Linden Hills and looking to buy one. There wasn't anything on the market when we were moving here in January. And my husband Tommy is, they're all here now and embracing the snow and the cold weather.
Sure choice.
Yeah, we have a positive attitude about it. I think it's beautiful and got a warm coat. So, and now just any questions you all have for me? And I guess I can give you just a little bit of background. Working with docents, I talked a lot to Debbie and Ann and Sheila about just the changes in the docent program here. And I also developed a BTS program in Memphis and really thought about visitor-centered practice within our docent training and kind of changed it from a, you know, strictly art history course to, you know, thinking about teaching strategies and methodology. So it sounds very similar to what kind of happened here over the, you know, the history of the docent program. So I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you. What would you?
That is just fine. You've been here months now, and I'm just curious what the opportunities you see here.
I think there's a lot of opportunities. I mean, one thing I would like to see is creating more interactive experiences, kind of self-directed interactive experiences within exhibitions. Amanda and I are thinking about that as well. You know, kind of partnering more with curators and thinking about maybe hands-on or multimedia, different experiences for visitors. I'm also very interested in seeing more art making. We've been talking about maybe the Alzheimer's program, the veterans program, and if there's logistically a way to have students have the opportunity to make art when they come on a tour. Those are just some of the things I'm thinking about. And then really thinking about the strategic plan. Thinking about creating more opportunities for teens. So those are just some of the things I'm thinking about right now.
I'm Colleen, and we've just met. Mm-hmm. What have you been wowed about here at the MIA? Having worked in other museums, what do you think stands out from the other places you've been having come here? What should we be proud of?
Well, I mean, I think the number of guided tours that you just showed me, I mean, that has wowed me. And I've heard Debbie say that what is the statistic, that we give more
guided tours?
More adult guided tours than the Met.
I mean.
Wow.
You're kidding.
Yeah, I know. I mean, that to me was just.
I think got that, I think it's, we do more school tours.
More school tours.
More school children come on.
Yeah, I mean, that to me, and then the collection, I mean, it's just.
What aspect of the collection?
I think the depth and breadth of it, and how many masterpieces we do have in the collection. And then also, I'm so impressed with just the staff here too. I mean, they're just so, there's so many passionate, smart people, and really just the focus on doing what we're doing, but then also thinking about innovating. So kind of that balance between the new and the, you know, continuing the great work we're doing.
Thank you. Okay, I'll ask you, what about the hierarchy here? Where do you fit into the great,
the institutional?
The institution, yes, where?
Well, I'm on the leadership team, so there, you know, there's Kaywin, and then there's Pat and Matthew, who were deputy directors, but I'm director, on the director level with like the director of, well, I guess she's the chief engagement officer. Kristen Prestigard, Julianne, who's the director of development, director of technology, that's where I.
Okay, thank you.
So I meet with the leadership team on a weekly basis. And if you have any ideas, questions, suggestions, there's, you know, my door's always open, there's my email, and you can call me too. I'm happy to. Yes.
With your position of the director of learning and innovation, I realize that we docents are not the only part of your job. What other, I don't know what we call departments, could you talk a little bit about who else do you work with besides docents?
Sure. Work with, well, I work closely with Sheila, thinking about teachers as audiences. And we're also really trying to kind of extend the reach of the museum and maybe change some mindsets. So I've been working with Sheila on developing a kind of a corporate creativity, maybe training program. Working really closely with Catherine Milton on developing online learning experiences. That's a big initiative within the strategic plan. And then as I mentioned before, Amanda, and thinking about interpretation and different in-gallery experiences, and then also, you know, youth programs, and I work with Susan Jacobson on public programs, and Katie on family programs. So really kind of, you know, anything that's educational, I'm involved in it. So.
And how about the, like, is it Julia with the teacher or the student classes, is that under learning and innovation?
Yes.
Also?
Yes, are you talking about like the weekend?
Weekend.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so that's also under sure.
And then of course Ann Isaacson with the collection of focus guides, and Annie Dressen with the art adventure guide program.
So you've got other staff people besides them.
Yes. Thank goodness. But Debbie's been on it. Yeah. But we do. I think we have 14 people in our division. Yes.
What are some of your thoughts about docent education, continuing education for us as docents?
Well, as I said, I think art history, you've got to have that, but also thinking about just different strategies and tools for engaging visitors on many different levels, and I don't think there's one right answer. I think you can, you know, have a variety of different ways and methodologies for engaging visitors, so I think kind of staying abreast of new thoughts on that, and for continuing education, but then also continuing to learn about the collection is important. So kind of both of those.
Along with that, you know, I think there might be some opportunities to work more with our 20 and 30 somethings museum visitors. And I know we've got the third Thursday and other things like that, but I think from a docent perspective, and giving tours, you know, that's a hard group to deal with. You know, we those of us that do kids tours during the school week, yeah, but that's always an interesting challenge as well. But I think those that are in their 20s and 30s and young 40s, you know, this is the next generation that's going to take over for those of us baby boomers. And if there's something, you know, some kind of, I don't know, new type of tour, whatever, I'm thinking, maybe tours that are led in conjunction with donors or, you know, 20, 30, 40-somethings that were maybe not, you know, that art isn't their, you know, work per se, you know, profession, but they've got some, you know, vested interest, I think would be fantastic, but that's just, you know,
I completely agree, and I think Debbie and I, and even a lot of us are trying to think about ways, because a lot of those third Thursdays, they're here for the party, they don't have to go to the galleries, and you know, oh, that kills me because you're at an art museum, so I think they should be interacting with some art. I mean, I think you need to take baby steps so that they're comfortable here. But we've been talking about maybe focusing on just one object, and maybe even relating it to a current event or something. So just, and if you have any ideas, we're open, but that's, the millennials are definitely a big focus of our institution because that is the next generation. But they experience things differently than a lot of us. So trying to think about different ways and strategies we can use to engage them and get them involved with the museum so they continue to come and, you know, hopefully volunteer or, you know, donate.
Thank you.
Yes?
Is there anything that keeps you up at night when you think about our challenges?
Trying to get everything done. But there's not anything. I think we have such a great team here. I mean, there are always challenges, but there's nothing that's really, and right now, maybe I'm too new to, of course, be keeping me up. But no, not that I can really think of. I think things are going pretty well.
I just wondered if there are any plans for a new adult training class. Because I know people in the classroom.
It's just crazy.
I'm an
Debbie? I'll refer to Debbie on that.
Well, it's a great question because we look at the numbers and we have a really good sized core right now. We also look, I'm starting to think about ways we can maybe change the dose of training. You know, we're always looking at how to do it. And so we don't have a next class plan yet. And that's what we're just keep telling people. I would say down the road, a couple of years, I definitely want another class. But I want some time to talk with Carmine and Anne and look at are there new ways to approach it, new opportunities. Some of the things you talked about today, but reaching younger people through those programs. So we went through a whole transitional period before some of the latest classes came where we changed up how we do it. And I think we have to keep looking and thinking and seeing what other museums are doing. So I'm in touch with people who do some training in other museums. So there's a lot of thinking to be done. This is such a great moment, you know, in terms of art and museums and potential for change. So that's my best answer. I'll just mention, Carlene is going to do a training for us. Maybe you just want to tell them a little bit about that.
Sure. I think it's in May. I mean, one of the areas of art that I love is modern contemporary. And I actually went to the Docent Symposium that was in Boston, must have been in 2005. I remember because I was pregnant with my second daughter. But I went to the Institute of Contemporary Art there and had a great experience with their staff about an approach of how to look at contemporary art. So it's a great way to, it's a lot of different strategies you can use with audiences, and I thought in conjunction with More Real that it'd be a very relevant training. So focusing on a few objects from that exhibition, but then also some from our permanent collection. And it'll be very, you know, discussion-based. It's a really good approach, and I hope you'll enjoy it and come.
Well, thank you so much.
Sure.
For being with us today. And we'll have lots of other opportunities.
Yes, I'm sorry
to
turn
that off.
Debbie, do you tell her how to say welcome again?
We're trying to cure you all. Next on our agenda, we have Ross Guthrie's here, Director of Security.
And we did some sessions for staff recently that have to do with breach of security, lockdown type situations, and unfortunately we're living in a world where terrible things are sometimes happening and we all need to be prepared for those situations. So I asked Ross to come and talk to you a little bit about the things that the museum is doing right now. I realize you guys are in the galleries with lots of people and kids, and so he's going to talk a little bit about that and again have some time for you to ask him questions.
Okay, thanks again, Debbie, for the opportunity. My 25-year-old millennial son, I asked him, why don't you come to the museum more often for, you know, your peer group? He said, if you had more craft beer and music. Okay, get right on that. I've been working at the museum since 1984. By the way, I'm a transplanted Okie, and I don't say go to. So thanks. It's nice to be here and have this opportunity. Kind of a serious subject, of course, and so what we do around here can be that way. I know many of you know the security staff. You're out there working with them and around them, and hopefully those experiences are positive. I always like to say, if you ever have a negative experience and you feel like talking about it and would like to, please direct that to me. Here, I have a phone too. You can call me. I'm also responsible for the cleaning function in this building. You may not know that. Not me personally. That would not be good. When I started working here, and it's been that way since, the cleaning staff reports to me, mostly because of when they work, which is nighttime. And so we have a higher level of security at that time, as you can imagine. So I manage that group. We have a couple foremen that actually run it. So they know what they're doing and take care of it. But I mention that because if you ever have any issue related to the cleanliness of the building, public side, non-public side, anywhere, let me know. I don't have anything to do with like the outside snow plowing, brushing, any of that, but I can help. I know who does. Just let me know. But I wanted to mention the cleaning part because that's not something that you would probably naturally think is my responsibility. We have a great cleaning crew. They all work for MIA. 8 of the 10 work at night, and they can do all their stuff, and I think they do a great job with that. So, security procedures. We've been working, actually focusing on this a lot lately, intensely, you might say, developing, reviewing, and in some cases creating new policies to deal with scenarios, emergency scenarios. There's lots of them out there. We ended up creating this sort of hanging flip chart for our staff to use, like, when if. This is also available, a lot of it's available on our intranet for them to look at electronically. So, a lot of things listed here. Some of them would be obvious, some maybe not so much. Fire, obvious, gas leak, missing child, medical emergencies, and on down the line. Some of them are less likely, but potentially possible. We've been meeting with supervisory staff and sharing this information with them, but then also enlisting their support to help us not only inform their staff, but create sort of mini security plans within each area for the unique situations they may have. So if you're in marketing, you have a plan that is that takes care of some of the unique things having to do with the marketing environment, so on and so forth. So that's what Debbie was commenting about, or on, that we have been having these supervisory meetings to not only inform, but also remind them of their responsibility to lead their group and know what's happening. The recovery of the collection is a whole other part, which we're not going to talk about. But you can imagine if we were to have a large scale incident like a fire or water leak, dealing with the art collection that's damaged is a huge thing, huge undertaking. Registration staff, curatorial staff, conservation land, all those people would be involved, and also potentially outside agencies helping us. This little side comment, this past Friday, we had in this room, I think it's the first we've had around here, the conservation lab put together something called the Alliance for Response. It brought, Colin and his group brought in first responders and representatives of emergency organizations from around our community and the state. The National Guard, for instance, was here to talk about planning and responding to disasters in museums and cultural properties. So you had all different levels of representation and input. We were here, other museums were here, and then all the way through fire, police, National Guards. We all got together, sort of talk shop, what if? It was great. And learned a lot about what resources are out there in the community. They learned a lot about this place because we happen to be hosting it in this environment. And it's eye-opening to them, this is not your average place. And they saw it firsthand, you know, what's hanging on the walls, what's stored in the storage environments. In addition to having 250 staff and thousands of guests at any particular time. It was a great event. Back to my topic. So we created this document, we shared it, we're working on it, we were having, we're starting to do drills. And one of the main things I wanted to talk about today, and get questions if you have them, is our lockdown drill. You hear about these things, excuse me, sir. Unfortunately, you hear about these things all the time. You know, whether it's a workplace shooting, a school, anywhere really, where there's an event that causes the environment to be locked down. And what that means for here is similar to what you've probably read or maybe know firsthand from other places you go, school kids, things like that. We would respond like those environments. And it would have to be a level of incident like a person with a gun or someone that's implied violence to a staff member, a visitor, or perhaps it's happened on a college campus or in the theater environment, since we're all so close. What would happen is once we decided that was necessary, your first notice, if you weren't otherwise aware from the hubbub or just word of mouth, over the PA system, you'd hear some loud horns. It would be unique, I'm guessing, you probably would not have ever heard it here unless you happen to be here when we ran a drill. But it's, you know, get your attention. Followed by a pre-recorded message about a lockdown. Have your attention, please. We're now going to lock down. And please get to the nearest available safe place. I can't remember verbatim, but it's essentially a message like that. Lockdown, you'll hear. So what's going to happen at that time is the security staff will shepherd guests and staff to safe environments. Now, back at house staff have procedures for their offices, those kind of places. We don't really go into that so much. I know you're probably in the guide office from time to time, maybe the docent lounge if you do that. Really, in those situations, you're just to remain there and lock the door if you can. Wait for the all clear. But if you're in the galleries, and that's really what we want to talk about mostly, the security staff is going to, again, shepherd you and anybody that's with you to the safe places. They're identified in the policy, and I'll just tell you kind of where they are. They should be familiar to most of you. The classrooms, in the commons, in those areas. Anybody know what that area is, the commons? I see a couple. The arts cafe, just down the hall, there's classrooms down there. We call that area the commons now, where the seating is. It used to be the head corridor, it used to be the American corridor. I've been here 21 years. It's the commons now. That is a place we would take people if they're not already in there, the kids. So that's an environment. We might shepherd people back of house behind the security doors, if that would make sense given the location of the incident. Moving up floors, well, this is a room, by the way, for this area up here. We can bring people in here. There's a lot of room. We can lock the door. on second level, Billsbury Auditorium is the environment we direct people to. We might go into Target Gallery, that's pretty securable. We can shut doors, lock doors, shut fire doors, do those kinds of things to make that a safe environment. Billsbury Auditorium, I mentioned, on the third level, the Villa Rosa Room, you may or may not have been in there. That's a good place to go, again, you can, it's big, you can lock the doors. Moving on around the third floor, really on over to the Target one, we've got some big spaces, the reception hall, we've been in there, the big party room, good place for that. So we have some designated areas we can direct people and help people get to. Having said that, these kind of situations might call for just your best judgment. You know, you see something going down, it's right in front of you, and Ross said go to the commons, but that's where the problem is, I'm not going there. You might have to do what's best for you at that time, including running out of the building. I've never been through a real scenario, hope I never am, one of these things. You can read about them, you can imagine the panic, the mayhem, etc. So there's going to be a lot of that going on. But you can count on us for alerting you to what's happening, probably over the PA. You can count on us to help get you to a safe environment, if that makes sense, given where you are. You can count on us, to some degree, keeping you updated on what's going on. And you can count on us telling you when it's safe to come out. I should have injected there, too. You can count on us notifying the authorities, obviously. We have some, we call them the big red buttons. They're around at the visitor desks and the soon to be at the information desk. Those are direct connects to 911. And they're treated essentially like hold-up alarms at a bank. So the protocol on the police end is like that. They're coming here fast with a lot of people. And so that would be the lockdown situation would be a time for us to activate that button if we're not otherwise able to call them, but we would push it anyway to know they're coming to help as well. So that's really our lockdown. There's a three-page policy, things in it that aren't really that important for this conversation. So I'd like to stop for now and ask any questions. Answer. Yes, ma'am.
It's not uncommon these days to go to museums elsewhere and have to go through security. However, incomplete that security process is, may I look in your bag, ma'am, kind of thing.
Right.
What conversations, if any, have you had about that, instituting that here?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not advocating it.
Yeah, I was just down in D.C. 2 weeks ago, so they have all this.
Yeah.
Screening, you know. Maybe other places too.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
We, right now, our position is that the security folks working at the desk are trained to observe and report. We don't have anything more than that in terms of screening for weapons or metal detector, that kind of stuff. It's been discussed most recently, and it's not that recent, but most recently, 9/11. There was some discussion about it at that time, like many places were doing. But we, as of today, we don't feel like it's necessary, although it's not, it's never put away for good. Sometimes situations around the country or the world, you know, dictate that. It could be we would do it maybe temporarily for some reason or another. But right now, it's training and including visitor services staff on observing and reporting any suspicious activity, the inspecting and checking of oversized parcels at the desk as well. We do that to help, you know, add to the safety program. But I hope that answers what you're asking. But that's what we do here. It just varies, you know, depending on where you are and what you consider the threat level is for that environment. I think the thing that causes me more concern, I guess is the word I would use, is you continue to read about these particular workplace shootings, you know, that kind of thing. What are we doing there for that? And that's extended on into the staff, and I've done some presentations for them to say, you know, please let us know, or human resources, if you're having issues in your personal life that you think might affect the work environment. If you have a relationship problem that might flood over to the workplace, if your coworker's having one and you know about it, tell HR, you know, tell us so we can be aware. It's sensitive. I know it, everybody's different about how they share information, but that's a big part of this too. A lot of times when you read about these things, you go back, somebody can say, oh yeah, I knew Ross was, you know, having a problem, and you know, he would complain or he'd get very angry about stuff, and you know, maybe if somebody would have said something, there might have been an opportunity to intervene. But that's really when it pops up for me more than anything. And it's sort of an ongoing discussion all the time. Do we have a comment about that or a question?
I just would comment that I also worry about those kinds of security procedures giving places a false sense of security, because they're not really very vigilant. I suppose you could probably get something through them if you wanted to, if you were determined to, and then other security procedures might be relaxed because people are depending on that perimeter security more than they should.
It's a really interesting point, and around here people, I think, sometimes attach a lot of things to what we do in terms of maybe the things they think we're paying a lot of attention to or more than what is reasonable, because I'll hear that from them. We pay attention to everything going on, and we talk and train about how to observe human behavior, but in this environment, it's a public building. So that balance between guests coming in and the staff, I suppose the staff thinking we're able to know everything about every person walking through, but that's not reasonable. But to a bad guy, you know, when they walk in here, they're gonna look around and see who's watching, what are they doing? They might even make some inquiries just to see what they get back. And then as they come on in the building, you know, what's there. But when you talk about these workplace shooting things, those are very passionate. You know, sometimes they shoot all the way into the person they're trying to get to. Sorry to say that, but you read these things. You know, on the way to the boss they hate, they shoot the 10 people. And so that is like a different level of situation. So again, what we've decided at this point is to have our 911 buttons, communicate, create a place to go to for safe haven until it's clear. That's where we are today. But that's really an ongoing discussion all the time, all over the place. Yes, sir.
We're all aware in the news there's been a lot of discussion about, you know, gun control. And in some states, they're arguing now that there should be guns in classrooms. The teachers should have guns. Is there any discussion of how we might deal with that?
Are we
going to
be armed?
Are the teachers that are coming to our
halls here on the table?
Yeah. is that an issue that that needs to be discussed?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Well, number one is, is there any discussion of arming staff here? Is there any discussion of how we'll react if schools become armed and teachers are armed?
And they come here with the weapon? I haven't had a discussion about that second part. I haven't really thought about it. It's a good one, actually.
Yeah.
You know, we have an off-duty police program for our security, as part of our security program. They're here around 30 hours a week. They are our armed response. With the exception of any exhibitions that come along and require that. It's rare these days, but it's happened. What we will do in those situations is contract out to probably a private security firm or maybe an extension of our off-duty police program, those resources. It does come up from time to time. There is no plan at this point to arm all the security staff or any other staff. That's the issue. But that's like this other question, that's an ongoing discussion. You know, this, I have an opinion that's different from that opinion from that one and that one, so we all put our heads together and decide what's reasonable. It would be my recommendation that we extend our off-duty police program if we were to do this. You just get a whole different level of person training, et cetera, when you do that. Yeah, we've had them here for maybe almost 20 years working with us, primarily outside, primarily afternoons and evenings. If you're around at those times, maybe you see a squad.
Yeah.
Fantastic group. Just a great group of people. Love this place. We get a certain kind of people. I don't care if they ever arrest one person. We just want it safe and secure, and they all get that. So it's nice to have them.
If I was going to my way into the building, I would do it in the morning in the school groups. First of all, I just want to say I have had only the best experiences with the guards.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Yeah. Absolutely. Checking to see if somebody needs to check an oversized bag or trying to look at behavior, counting the number of visitors that walk through the door, answering questions, and in the mayhem of a lobby full of noise, chaos,
right,
and excitement. I mean, the good kind, right?
Yeah.
I would hope that they feel like they have enough staff backing them up, because it's
a lot.
Yeah. So when you mentioned afternoon and evening,
yes,
my thought is
right.
So would you address that, please?
Yeah, I will. Thanks for the nice comments, by the way.
Oh, they're great.
That front desk can get extremely busy at times, and so we do have a priority of things they're supposed to be watching for.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is watching of the doors of the people. I understand they get distracted. So some of them are better at it than others. Some of them want to take care of visitors more than others. That's not because they're a better person. It just, that's what their thing is. So we try to say, these are the things you gotta be doing all the time. It's kind of a skill set that varies with our group. We have a second person inside the door, usually, maybe you notice, maybe you don't, up on the stair. They're back up to that person. So I'm watching you down there, and if somebody comes through, then maybe they catch them.
Because the kind manner with which they greet everyone, they are the face of the museum.
Absolutely.
So,
yep, and we ask them to be that and train on that while they're watching for the bad guy. This, we don't have the resources at this time to have, say, that off-duty program all the time. So I pick the times based on activity level, crime statistics, etc. You know, to say we need you here on these days at these times because those reasons. So hopefully, when it gets busy, we've got the backup. Our control room operators are watching. We have a fancy new camera out there, by the way, in the lobby. It's a multi-lens. It basically gives us a 360 out of one environment. When you walk in, if you look up, you might be able to see it. I think it's a clear dome, but anyway, it's neat. So Sheila down there in the control room has that ability to, you know, watch as well.
Ah.
So we've got layers of things happening. In addition to just used to other people around that might go, what's that? You know, this is one of the hardest things I try to get across, or hard to get across, is people fight instincts to say something about somebody, and you're not saying they're a bad person, you're just wondering why they're here. So if you see somebody you don't know, and you know that red flag pops up in your head, just say something to a security person. I saw that man, I saw that woman, not sure what's going on, but it just seemed odd, different. Would you check? We come up and professionally inquire. Can I help you, sir? Can I help you find a staff member at the back of your house? Can I help you find something in the collection? And start that engagement. You know, hopefully it's just someone lost. But if everybody's doing that, and I know you have other jobs and duties, but we're just that much stronger. But I tell you, something will happen every so often, and somebody will go, you know, I saw that guy, and I thought he was, well. But, you know, we're trained to not look at somebody and go, oh, that guy might be up to something, or whatever. You kind of fight that sometimes, and that's real, though. You know, and if you're out in your community or your neighborhood or if you're shopping, you know, you see that, you're probably a little stronger about it for your own personal safety when you see stuff. So just let us know. We're not going to send the brute squad, at least not right on. How am I doing, Debbie?
We're doing well. We can do another 10
minutes. I have a question over here. Get to you in a second. Yes, ma'am.
Missing Child Protocol?
Yes, good. That's called the 1031 in our environment. Everything has that number. You know, I don't know if it's still true, the FCC used to say you can't just talk, you have to have codes to be efficient. But I think since 9/11 they learned some things about that, the communication. But anyway, we have one. And what's in that policy is the procedure for security, visitor services, and museum shop staff.
So as a docent, my first call is to the nearest security.
Absolutely. And that's so we start to head at the doors, they take up a different posture, very much more vigilant for screening. Bathrooms, we start looking, start fanning out and looking for these young people. I don't know if any of you come to Rock the Cradle, that 89.3 radio station. Mm-hmm. It's hugely popular. I mean, 15,000 people. And we probably have 10 to 20. I get so anxious. I come to that event because I can't stand being home. I get so anxious when I hear that, you know. And the theater, you know, same thing. We've had some young people, I mean, bless their hearts, but it's kind of incredible. Right? We had a four-year-old go all the way to the parking lot where they parked. Oh, you know, he just thought, well, that's, you know, where we are. So he, some nice citizen found him and brought him back. So anyway, we have it, but yeah, if you'll just let us know, we'll immediately, it comes over the radio, 1031, that means something to everybody, and we start getting after it. So, yeah.
I happened to be here last fall when the lights went out in the morning, shortly before the museum opened.
Power outage.
It was the power outage, sure. And it lasted for quite a while.
Okay.
And I was in the galleries preparing for a tour when the lights went out, and then all of a sudden, I've never experienced this before, grates started to come down, like between galleries.
Yes.
And, okay, so I have kind of like two questions.
Okay.
If the museum, well, would it have been, I got out of there as fast as I could.
She slid under the gates.
Does that happen such that the galleries are enclosed ever? And if I had been, if it had been 10:30 instead of 9:45 and I had been there with 20 third graders, what would the protocol have been then?
First, get out from under it, obviously, yeah. They some gravity drop and some actually there's like a high tension spring. Those are fire shutters.
Okay.
So what's going on there? In some cases, when the power is lost to certain areas of the building, those things shut for safety reasons. They're there to compartmentalize the building in the case of a fire, spread of smoke and fire. So that's why they do that. You should get out from under it. Again, none of them go bam or shouldn't. But yeah, stay clear. Most of them aren't even supposed to do that in a power outage, but we have five generations of building here, and so depending on where you are, every power outage, I'm telling you, I've been here 21 years, there's something different. We think we've got it figured out, and then, you know, this thing doesn't work. It's weird. So get out from under it. There's no need to really panic in that situation, because the power outage typically is something external by Excel that's affected us. If it is an emergency scenario, we'll say over the speaker to please evacuate. You know, I'm thinking what that might be. Well, if it's like severe weather, we probably would just get you to a safe part of the building, not ask you to leave. But in any event, yeah, get out from under there and just stay where you are until security comes around. Did that answer?
Sure.
I didn't know you experienced that. Yeah, that.
It made me thankful that I had my flashlight with me, because it took a while. The lights went out, and then there must be emergency lighting somewhere. Okay. Eventually that came on, but it was probably only 3 seconds or so. It was pitch black.
Which gallery were you in?
I was in one of the contemporary galleries.
Okay.
And I saw the
over here on this end?
In the carpet, yeah.
Really? Did you have any light?
No. Not at first.
Okay.
Then at
the generator maybe kicked in. Yeah.
So carrying a flashlight, I decided, was a good idea for a number of reasons.
Always, and you're, you know, if you have the kind of phones, you get
the flashlight.
Yeah, I use that thing all the time. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, sir.
It was a couple of years ago, I think, it was during the day. All of a sudden, all the doors closed because the magnets let go. But I think there are panic bars, so you can get out of the gallery.
That's right.
The lights hadn't gone off, but there was a big bang on the doors.
Yeah. those are tied to the fire system. So if we have a certain kind of fire alarm, they release and close. And then also, if we have a power outage in some areas, those release as well because they're energized. And then they shut when they close. But if you're ever, you can always egress. Every one of those things is made so you can get out from whatever environment you're in. So that you just try to remain calm. You can always get out. And there's a lot of us around to help too. But it can be alarming, I know. But you know, the McKim Mead building, the old, you know, the middle is probably the worst in terms of, you know, electrical gremlins. Yeah.
Yes. Are the stairwells a good place to go in the case of emergency or a lockdown? You didn't mention them at all.
Yes, they are. A staff member asked that question. Absolutely, because they are, well, I'll say this, they are and they aren't. They lock from the inside. So if you go in there,
you're locked in.
Well, you're locked in, but also if the bad guys are around, they can come in too. But if that's your closest access, go for it. Get out of the main corridor and get away. You know, we kind of got hung up for a while on that kind of question because staff were saying, well, if I go in there, the lock and this and that, just get away and get in. If you have to put something against the door, you wouldn't be able to do that in the stairwell.
Yeah.
But you know, you go in a stairwell and you're trying to get away from, say, a lockdown, just go on out.
Well, that's right. You could go down the stairs.
Absolutely.
And out the door.
Yep. Just head on out of the building.
Yep.
That's just fine, too. But other scenarios, power outage, don't. I mean, tell you what to do, but for our sake, please don't. When people go in stairwells, that gets us really excited, and we may want to be dealing with other issues. So try to avoid it in a power outage. Fire, absolutely. But bottom line is, if you think it's what you need to do for safety's sake, you do it. We'll figure out the details later.
I don't even know where.
I know. I was just thinking that same thing.
Just look for those kind of signs. You know, they're really important environments for safety, but also for us because we have all the art in here. If you go through an emergency one and there's nothing going on of emergency nature, we're going to come checking it out. In fact, well, I don't see him in here. There's a guy that
we had
the docents.
We had training on that during our docent training.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just maybe a couple things to help mission people. But how many security guards are on duty at time?
Good question. I'll start from the top. There's 63 on the roster. We have 11 off duty. We have 8 outside. So we've got maybe 80-ish right now on the roster. But we're 24/7 inside out. When the Warriors were here, we had about 34 on duty during a typical day. We drop down and that environment closes. So we're usually around 27-ish any given day, depending on sick calls and stuff like that.
27 throughout.
There's 8 of them in fixed positions behind the scenes, whether it's a control room or a loading dock or something like that. The rest are out in the public areas. Yeah.
Is there any chance that you have a scope so that
I heard there was one started one time, only because somebody put something on there about me. We don't have one. That's an interesting idea. Obviously, all the individuals have them, but that's their own personal thing.
That's an interesting thought. I had never thought of that.
Are the guards pictured on the infamous?
They are.
Staff?
They are.
But we can't get on the internet.
Well, I think that maybe
we
could have internal access. I'm going to look into that because staff are, in general, are pictured on the intranet site.
Well, it's interesting. Maybe our admin Janet might be interested in sort of managing that Facebook page for us and see about that. There'd be some value there. Other stuff? Medical? Any questions about medical things? We respond, we're trained, we're sort of first responders for this building. Basic first aid, defibrillation, use of defibrillator, CPR, that kind of stuff. So we'll do that. Beyond that is the professional help from outside. Yeah.
The only question I have is I have had some forms where, especially that something that we should talk in advance about? We know it's going to happen on the toilet.
Even if you just, when you get here, say to whoever's nearby, we have this for medical reasons, that's fine. Yeah, please do. We issue medical backpack tags at the desk if you're aware of that. Some folks have to bring some things in if you do that.
Which is going to happen because we talked about quick response. There was a woman on the mezzanine Monday that was choking.
Yeah.
And they were there within 1 second. There was someone who was up by the windows. She was in the bathroom when she came out. So the guard was at the desk, called somebody for like four people there by the bench. And one of my tours where the elevator decided there was a fourth floor, and so 12 people came about a foot higher than the third floor level. We had four guards outside, and we had a file from the elevator company, and a good conversation going on for 40 minutes before they could go out. Then they wanted to go on their tour.
That first one, I should tell you, Todd Newman received a Citizens Award for that from the police department. Yeah, we went to a ceremony in the precinct here, and Todd was recognized for saving that woman's life.
She was hurt. A choking one?
Yeah.
She brought her whole family and grandkids over here to meet him, and it was really touching. And also, really cool that our training, you know, he actually said, we have a St. Louis Park firefighter that trains us on first aid, and when he talks about the Heimlich, he says, do not be afraid to break ribs if you have to, because it might take that kind of vigor, and it did. We didn't break the ribs, but it took extra. Other folks tried before Todd to dislodge the food, and it was unsuccessful, so Todd put a little more into it, and it worked, and he remembered our trainer telling him that.
I think I got hit the first one because he was sitting out there at one of those tables and it hadn't worked. And so when he came in, he just did.
Yeah, that was really, really cool. And, you know, here, Grandma got to have another holiday season with the kids and grandkids. And